The picture of the week for me was Donald J. Trump, the President of the United States, the most powerful man in the world, struggling to cup his hands securely enough to lift a glass of water to his lips and sip it without choking or dropping it. If any further evidence was needed that this man is in the grip, virtually certainly, of early onset Alzheimer's, then this provided it. The man who, you'll recall, needed two hands to pick up a small plastic water bottle just the other day when he was telling us about the problems of Puerto Rico being surrounded by water. Big water has a real issue with water. His filmed inability to lift a glass of water to his lips this week has set in motion a lot of cats amongst a lot of pigeons. Because venal or not, and that's an open question still, the fact that he's an idiot is surely incontestable. An idiot no longer in full control of his physical, never mind his mental capabilities. I'm not prying into his incontinence nappies. I know nothing about those. But I do know that this is not a man that it's safe to leave in possession of the football, the nuclear football. We'll be talking, as always, this week, as every week, for the last year or more, about Donald Trump. But I just thought I'd get that off my chest. Now, here's this. I've happened upon an email from John Gaunt to James Will. It says, "Good evening, Mr. Will. Happy to hear you're over the hip-hop saga and back on talk radio where you belong. After recently spending a few hours researching Flat Earth on YouTube, I've become a Flat Earther." And he goes on, "It would be great if you could get that number one Flat Earther, Mark Sargent, on your great show." So there you have it, folks. John Gaunt is a Flat Earther. What a surprise, said nobody anywhere ever. We're talking today about Brexit, which reaches new levels of tragedy or farce, depending on your point of view. We'll be reviewing the music year with some considerable experts, and we'll be talking to counter-terrorism advisor Simon Trundle about the Christmas terror plots. These were unveiled or unmasked in Sheffield and Chesterfield, where people have been arrested, allegedly, for planning to cause carnage over Christmas. And that's a very serious story, of course. As may or may not be the UFO story. Now, there are more things on heaven and earth than are dreamt of in our philosophy, Horatio and all. I've always believed that. I'm in no doubt about it at all. But I don't know much about UFOs. But I was grabbed by this story and by the video which accompanied it, which appeared to show an extraterrestrial craft without wings, turrets or rotors, which moved at a pace of acceleration undreamt of in our age. No one could possibly keep up with it. No human could be sitting on it. The G-force would disintegrate them. And it's there on video. And it turns out there's been a secret UFO department in the United States Department of Defense set up by a very senior senator, Harry Reid, a former leader of the Democratic senators in the U.S. Senate, which has spent millions establishing that craft from elsewhere have indeed been visiting the Earth. And lastly, Uber. Uber are a taxi company, don't you know? Of course, they always denied that. They said they were an app, but I insisted all along, right from the beginning, that they were a taxi company. Now, the European Union has so ruled, and Uber is being run out of just about every town anywhere in the world. Tweet me as Katie Morgan Waple, Waple, W-A-P-L-E, says, oh, I do love a Scottish accent. George Galloway on Talk Radio. Thank you very much indeed for that. Now, I declare an interest. I'm a columnist under the editorship of my next guest. He's Michael Heaver. He's the founder of Westmonster.com. That's Westmonster, of course, not to be confused with the monsters at Westminster. Now, Michael, I'm guessing, is just about as bemused as me and I think the rest of us as to where we are on Brexit. Michael, welcome to the show.
How you doing, George? All right?
I'm good, and the better for talking with you. Now, I postulated last Friday that Brexit was in fact now dead, that it would be killed by the decision in the House of Commons that the whole matter, once the negotiations are complete, must be brought back for a meaningful vote in the House. I have said all along, as you know, not least in your columns, that there's a clear majority in the House of Commons against Brexit. So it's obvious to me that the EU will drive such a bargain that no one will want to vote for it. What say you?
Well, I think bemused is a good word you used earlier. I think, very interestingly, the House of Commons is the least of our worries, because don't forget that the big thing that I'm worried about, which hasn't been picked up as much, is the House of Lords now, of course, will get a veto. And don't forget, the House of Lords has 100 Lib Dem peers.
108, let me correct you. 108 Lib Dem peers.
It's gone up.
Yeah.
So you've got all them, you've then got various, ex-mates and former prime ministers and people on EU pensions, left, right and centre. And I actually think that's going to be even harder to get through the Lords than the Commons. And really, George, for me, there's two things here. And I'm someone, I'm a long time committed Brexiteer. I've campaigned for, I fought for it a long time. There's a sense of radicalism that's being lost in all of this. When people voted on June 23rd, 2016, I remember the day, people knew that whatever way this went, this was a huge, historic day.
Yes.
And ever since then, we've had these MPs who have basically tried to say, well, they didn't know what they were voting for, they didn't vote for that, such a radical agenda, they didn't vote to come out of the customs union single market. The fact is, I think people genuinely thought two things. This was about radical change if we did leave, and that it would happen quickly. Not 5, 6, 7 years, whenever MPs, whenever governments get round to it. And day by day now, we see politicians who never wanted this to happen, never even wanted a referendum, certainly didn't want us to leave, now seeking to speak for the very people who went out and voted and presume to know what they stand for and what their motivations are. And that's what I really find sick of it.
Well, it's disgusting, and it's very dangerous. It compounds the democratic crisis in this country, which has been growing throughout this century, actually.
Yep.
The political class in such low order that if they told you that it was dark outside, you'd really have to go to the window to check. And the reality is, this will be regarded by a significant number, and I mean millions, in the country as a rank betrayal. And it will drive the political class standing in the country to undreamt of depths.
And the thing that really worries me, George, with this is that I'm getting tweet after tweet, day after day now, of people who, some of them never voted in their life, certainly hadn't maybe voted for 10 or 15 years, who thought, this is the big one. This is the one that really matters. If I go and give the government a mandate, as they said, to implement my decision to leave the European Union, that will really change things. And the thing that's really worrying, because I think this is genuinely dangerous now, is that people are turning around to me and saying, well, I voted leave, it isn't happening, what's the point? If I vote in an election, nothing changes. If I vote in a referendum, politicians decide to speak to me and seem to presume my motivations. What is the point of democracy when I vote for something, my side, on the rare occasion that it does win, because so many people are in safe, MP seats, but when my side did win, when I did vote for radicalism, when the establishment were defeated, if it increasingly feels as if it counts for absolutely nothing. And when people despair of democracy and give up on the ballot box, that I think is genuinely dangerous. That is the burden that all politicians in this country have on their shoulders. Whatever they personally believe was the right decision before the referendum, they are there to implement the decision. That is what the government said they were there to do, not to presume to cast judgment on what the motivations were. We knew what they are. It was to end open borders. It was to make Parliament supreme. It was to end the jurisdiction of European courts. And it wasn't to do it in 5, 6, 7, 8 years' time. It was to do it now. Time to get on with it.
And neither was it to pay a king's ransom for leaving a club, money that is desperately needed in this bleak midwinter to keep our pensioners warm, to make sure our children have a breakfast in them when they go to school, and so on. The whole thing has been a mess from start to finish. We should have implemented or triggered Article 50 on day one. We should not have negotiated anything about ongoing commitments until all other matters were resolved in the negotiation. The cart was put completely in front of the horse, and the result is a pantomime horse now. We've got a government which is bereft of credibility and majority, and we've got a European Union that is pumped up. It knows that it's got the British government on the ropes, and that to some extent the British government wants to be on the ropes. Theresa May never believed in Brexit. Neither does our next door neighbour, the Chancellor of the Exchequer. We've got a parliament that wants to be given a set of proposals from Europe that most people will regard will be repulsed by the size of the bill, the ongoing commitment to free movement of cheap European labour, and so on. And people, they're hoping that people will conclude, well, actually, there was no point in all of this, and just walk away.
Well, what it speaks to me is that politics in this country has got so sterile that you've got essentially a group of politicians. You know, when you see Prime Minister's questions, you see Theresa May there flanked, as you say, Philip Hammond on one side, Damien Green on the other. The Remainers are well and truly, undoubtedly, running the show still. And it's a sense of, you know, they're taking an incredibly conservative, small-C approach to this. At no stage have they sort of set a deadline to the EU. At no stage have they said, this is our final bottom-line offer, here is your deadline, and these are what we believe are our bottom-line demands, take it or leave it. At every stage the EU has dictated, it has made the government dance to its tune. I don't think the government's been nearly enough aggressive in communicating what it's seeking to achieve in its end game and how it's going about it. And I think it's allowed the EU to completely dominate the narrative. I think some of the press in this country is to blame as well, by the way, because I think the way that some of the press, the British press, hook, line and sinker, you know, when Michel Barnier says something, it becomes gospel. Well, no, of course, they're negotiating on their side as well, so I don't think that helps. But in terms of the government explaining and setting out a vision, and as I go back to it, the spirit of June 23rd, 2016, Independence Day, that's really what they should be going on. That's really, you know, that sense of real optimism. And even a lot of Remainers that I know that voted to Remain that day, even they now say, what is going on? Why are we not seeing any progress? Why is there talk now of 2021? Of course, when you think about this transition implementation period, that's what people have to realise. Nothing major here is going to change till 2021. And you look back upon the political year we've had over the last 365 years, I wouldn't like to cast judgment on where we're going to be in 4 years' time. And that makes me incredibly nervous. They're essentially saying, well, no, don't worry, we'll come out of the EU technically now, but we'll implement all the changes in 3 or 4 or 5 years' time, who knows. That makes me nervous. It should make Brexiteers nervous because, of course, we just don't know in the current political climate where we're going to be in those 4 years.
Well, the dichotomy seems to me this, that we either have a set of proposals that are voted on in the House, final deal, voted down, and then we're in a kind of limbo, neither in nor out of the European Union, and a referendum result extant, but a failed process of leaving. Or, and this is almost the best case scenario, although for me it's even worse than remaining in the EU, is that we leave the EU technically, but we have to implement the so-called four freedoms on an ongoing basis if we want to trade with them. The most important one being the so-called free movement of cheap European labour, depressing wages, putting up rents, pressing on public services and so on. If we remain in the customs union, if we remain in the single market, we haven't left the EU in practical terms. And the reason I say it's worse is that we will have no influence at all in the EU. We've got precious little as it is. Anybody has precious little as it is, but we'll have zero. But we'll still have to live with all of the decisions that are made by the European Union. That's even worse than remaining in it, isn't it?
I mean, it's horrendous where we are. When you look at, well, I think what the government and what politicians tend to do, they live in that bubble, don't they? And the headline of what Michel Barnier said today, you're absolutely right. He stood up and said, word for word pretty much, the UK will have to abide by all EU laws, not just the ones here now, but new ones that are coming in, until the end of the transition. We're talking into the 2020s here. And hey, I don't for a minute believe or trust politicians enough, so if they tell me a deadline's 2021, that they might not just kick the can down the road a few extra years. Oh, you know, it's been a two-year period, becomes a three, becomes a four. And it's that sense of nothing actually changing, the whole process being held up, there not being enough sense of radicalism about this, of just get on and get on with it and deliver for the people. And I think really that, as I say, there's a potential breakdown in trust here. The public aren't interested in silly little games in Westminster, of vetoes, of mealy-mouthed words, of party political conflict. They voted for radical change. They wanted it delivered, I think, reasonably within that two-year Article 50 period. We're now talking about another 2 years on top, amidst which we're going to have to abide by all EU law, freedom of movement, open borders, the whole lot, the whole kit and caboodle. And people are going to look at this and think, what are you doing? We've given you the mandate. Why aren't you implementing it? And that, I think, is the real danger. Again, it's the breakdown in the democratic process if people feel like they're being badly let down and their democratic mandate is wasted and thrown away by people who simply just need to get on with the job but seem more interested in dithering and delaying, I'm afraid.
Now, finally, we now know that which most of us did that are taking a close interest in these things, that Mr. Tony Blair and his former cabinet minister, Mark Malloch Brown, who was made a peer and a cabinet minister on the same day by Tony Blair. Mr. Malloch Brown and Tony Blair, they've been running this show, it seems to me.
Yeah, no, I think one of the big undercurrents of the referendum, there was a certain class aspect to it, I firmly believe that. And a lot of the people now that you see that are fighting for the status quo, you know, these people are fighting for us to be governed from Brussels. They're fighting so that Britain can't negotiate global trade deals. They're fighting so that we can't regulate and control who comes into our country. And they're fighting for that because it suits them very well. So, yeah, you've got the Ramona rebels now led by unelected lords, Tony Blair, you know, former UN diplomat. That speaks volumes, doesn't it? This is not a people movement, a groundswell that you saw for so many years slowly building, bubbling away across the country, a mass movement of the people wanting their democratic rights back, wanting to be able to cast their vote that really matters so they can control their borders and determine their own courts and all the rest of it. What you're seeing now is a load of quite rich, quite privileged people, a lot of them unelected, and they want to maintain the status quo. And I see this as now as a fundamental battle. You know, if these guys have their way, George, make no bones about it. If this, let's say the Brexit deal goes to the House of Lords, and the House of Lords vote this down, and they essentially veto Brexit, you are going to have a constitutional crisis in this country, because people are not going to stand for it. They didn't vote to come out of the unelected, you know, the anti-democratic European Union to be overruled by a bunch of unelected people in Westminster who want to maintain a system that they've done very well out of, that has screwed so many British workers. I hope we don't go down that path. I hope they respect the mandate. But I must tell you, I'm growing incredibly pessimistic now, because now I see Lord after Lord, MP after MP, coming out of their own rationale about the people didn't vote for this, they didn't vote for that, apparently Leave voters went in and we wanted to maintain open borders. We wanted to stay in the single market. It's absolute rubbish. They should be very careful. They should respect the mandate. And let's get on. And actually, I would like to see some of the politicians, some of them quite able politicians, by the way, who campaigned for Remain, get behind and put in positive ideas for how we can maximise the benefits of Brexit for our country.
I just saw some pigs flying past my window.
Well, Michael, we live in optimism. We live in hope.
Michael Heaver, editor and founder of Westmonster.com, thanks for joining me. So much to talk about, from Brexit to UFOs. And where do so many of these stories come from? It is obvious now. They're not coming from the snail mail newsprint newspapers, who are increasingly following the online internet, Twitter, Facebook, and all the rest of it. I myself am quite ahead of the curve on this. I have more than 1 million, in fact 1.1 million now, followers on all of these platforms, and I do, together with my wife, most of it myself. So as people of my age go, I'm quite well up on it. But my guest is far, far sharper than I. She's Sophie Jarvis, Programs Director of the Entrepreneurs Network, which sounds like a hell of a network, I must say. Sophie, welcome to the show. You're doing this trending review. Explain to people first what you mean by trending review, would you?
Sure. So yeah, I basically go through, I flick through the newspapers in the morning and sort of pick out some stories, what I think would be interesting. And then we sort of sit and have a chat about it for half an hour. So
go ahead then. Tell me what's trending.
What's trending? Yeah, so they're sort of the popular stories of the day. We'll start with the smoking ban in jails and in job centres. So the Supreme Court ruled yesterday that the smoking ban wouldn't have to be enforced in public sort of run buildings such as jails and job centres.
Why job centres? I get jails, but why job centres?
I think the point is that they're publicly owned buildings.
And so people are to be allowed to smoke in there?
Yeah, they can. They can on the premise. So presumably it still means outside, sort of like near it, just not. But I think the main point is the jail's point, that it's this idea of prisoners being allowed to smoke in the jails and sort of like in the surrounding areas. Because the reason why it's the sort of, you know, came to a head is because a sick prisoner said that he was very ill from secondhand smoke.
Yeah.
So this is how this is all sort of
well,
come
they
about.
They are open to that charge. I was a long time being converted on the smoking ban. I did smoke until 2.5 or almost 3 years ago now, and I felt it draconian at the time. I still feel to some extent that there's an anti-smoking hysteria, which compared with the license, if you'll forgive the pun, that alcohol has, and alcohol is, I still believe, far more damaging than tobacco as a drug. But I can see the point about jails, you know. It's very important, especially now that we have so few prison warders. Their staff are under a great deal of pressure of numbers, pressure of morale. If you take cigarettes away from men that are locked up for, or women for that matter, for many, many years, you're kind of asking for trouble.
Yeah, that's what I think. I think there are sort of two arguments around here. I think first of all, you can sort of take the approach that you're in prison, like you're not allowed alcohol in prison. So, you know, these people that have done these crimes should be punished. So why should they be allowed the privilege? And then I think the other argument is the one that you've just said. You know, they've sort of got nothing. They're in prison. They're much more likely to get quite angry if they don't have their cigarettes. So actually, would the prison just be run better if they were allowed the cigarettes? And if the point of prison is to rehabilitate people, then I think I think we've got to look into, does taking cigarettes make people less likely to reoffend?
Of course, the cigarettes are the least of the problems in jails now. They're flying drugs in by drone.
Yeah.
They're training pigeons to home in on cell block H. To deliver the goods. There's people smuggling in, it's a family show, smuggling in very small mobile telephones in all kinds of unorthodox ways. There's a real problems about security in jail. I think probably
cigarettes,
20 capstan full strength is just about the least of their worries, don't you?
No, I agree. I think there are definitely bigger fish to fry. So
tell me, what's next?
Well, seeing as I just said the word fish, there is quite an interesting fish story. So,
a brilliant segue, I must say. I like a segue, Sophie.
That wasn't deliberate, actually. That wasn't sort of planned. But no, so some sea lions and dolphins off the coast of the Gulf of Mexico are in danger of being deafened by loud orgies of Mexican fish. So these fish are having sex so loud.
Fish fornicating.
Yeah.
So loudly. What kind of loudness? I mean,
So they're sort of saying like it's as loud as like a roar of like a rather large stadium. Like it's really, really quite loud. Or like when a swarm.
How fascinating! Do you have any audio of this?
Pardon, do I have any audio? I don't.
I think the show is incomplete without some audio of this phenomenon. The clever people behind the glass are going to try and find some or mock some up. I'm fascinated. Do go on.
Yeah, so it's okay. So basically, because the fish are being so noisy, the fishermen have sort of like located, they know where they are because they're so easy to find when they have these big orgies. And consequently, scientists are sort of calling for the preservation and the sort of like banning of fishing of these fish, because it's obviously quite a spectacle hearing these fish, massive groups of them. And they're quite big fish. They're like 3.5 foot. So this isn't like little
minnows.
This is rather large fish, so I can imagine why it sort of creates so much sound. But I don't know, I feel a bit sorry for the
size isn't everything, of course, and the fact that these fish are congregating off the Gulf could be a major tourist attraction. I mean, I could see,
people,
intrepid travellers going to visit this phenomenon.
Certain type of traveller going to visit.
Well, yeah, but I've been, I'm an avid watcher of the Blue Planet which is the greatest thing ever made on television, and David Attenborough ought to be the king of Britain, if you ask me. Now, in this, I've learned that fish are much more complicated than one thought they were. One sees them on the plate with chips, one thinks nothing of eating them, but in fact, a lot of these fish, and you've just given us the news that fish are capable of having orgies and making a noise whilst doing it. I watched on the Blue Planet the other day a fish that goes into a crevasse as a female fish and bulks up and its teeth grow and its demeanour changes, and it swims out a week or so later as a man, as a male fish. So fish are capable of changing sex.
Gender.
Got to be careful nowadays with these classifications. And I watched as an octopus disguised itself, covered itself in shells as a kind of suit of armour to see off a pyjama shark. Who knew there was a pyjama shark? Perhaps it's on its way to the orgy. So it's all very fascinating down there, if you forgive the pun.
No. I think Blue Planet's really good. I really like the music on Blue Planet as well, actually. They've got Radiohead and Hans Zimmer have written it, and it's really good. But I think something that Blue Planet's really good at highlighting is the fact that obviously we're sort of really polluting our oceans with a lot of plastic.
For sure.
And that's really, like, obviously that's horrible to see, but I think it's quite good that Blue Planet and David Attenborough sort of put that hat on of sort of saying, guys, this is really quite bad, we need to address this. So I was very happy to see that Michael Gove, who's currently like a bit of a PR machine with his department, has sort of got this 4-point plan on how to, sort of reduce the plastic that's in our oceans.
Well, good for him. If our seas are in the hands of Michael Gove, I shall rest not so easily. Let's take a break for some capitalist messages. My clever friends behind the glass claim that they cannot find any audio of these fish orgies off the Gulf of Mexico, but I think it's all about the watershed myself, if you'll forgive the pun. I'm talking with a very smart young lady, Sophie Jarvis, Programmes Director of the Entrepreneurs Network, on the stories that are trending today. Tell us more, Sophie.
So we'll go over the pond to America.
It's a very watery metaphor.
It is. I promise I didn't plan it. So Trump is on the cusp of the biggest slashing in US tax in 30 years. So he's going to slash corporation tax from 35% to 21%, and he's decreasing income tax across the board. So I think a lot of Americans are going to be quite happy at this. They're going to view this as a Christmas present, and that's what sort of Trump's wrapped it up as. But for me, I don't think, obviously all the papers are sort of saying this is a tax cut. I think this is very much a tax shift, because ultimately this hasn't been costed. Trump's not decreasing government spending. So ultimately this is going to add to the US deficit, and ultimately future generations will have to pay for this. So
indeed. Of course, if you reduce income tax across the board, you are by definition giving to the richest people very much more than you are to the poorest people. 10% of, I was going to say a word I'm not supposed to say before 7 o'clock. 10% of not very much is one thing, but 10% of a very great deal is a very great deal. Isn't Trump just putting dollars in stuffing their mouths with gold, those who supported him?
Yeah, I guess so. I mean, everyone obviously likes a tax cut, but or, you know, a reduction in tax. But I think over time, people will start to question, like, where's the money coming from if we're not, you know, if the government aren't getting it back. I think obviously his idea, and this is very much a big gamble, that he hopes that the extra revenue that he's losing through tax will sort of come in the form of people spending more, and then people, you know, obviously therefore companies being created and sort of increasing GDP. So there obviously is that argument, and he's hoping that's going to outweigh the tax cuts, but it's a big gamble. But I don't think he really cares. Like,
well, he probably won't be around to to count the chickens as they come home to roost. We have had that kind of attitude to spending and taxing in the United States before. It didn't come on previous occasions to anything very good, but he is on to something, I think, by effectively saying the deficit doesn't mean nearly as much as people say that it does. And I think that he's right about that. If you use the money that you're increasing the deficit by to do things which are important and will engineer more spending, more growth in the economy.
Yeah.
The problem is, with so little now made in America, comparatively, relatively, and so much of it made elsewhere, in China and elsewhere, if you give people more money to spend, Americans are going to spend most of it on foreign goods. Chinese goods in particular.
Yeah.
Thus increasing the imbalance in the economy between China and the US.
Exactly. I think the reduction in corporation tax is really going to annoy the EU, because I think it's going to take quite a lot of business away from them, because they've now got this sort of newfound land where businesses can sort of set up at a lot lower corporation tax rate. So,
do you know what he's reducing it from to?
Sorry, he's reducing it from 35% to 21%. That's the corporation tax.
Okay, very, very it's interesting.
It's more in line with, obviously, like our corporation tax. So.
He's not going to be around, I think. It's very unlikely that he'll finish his term, either because he'll be in jail or because whatever degenerative ailment he's currently suffering from will have reached crisis proportions.
Yeah.
Did you see him?
Yeah, well, I saw him.
Speaking of water, again, did you see him trying to drink that water?
I did. He looked like he was sort of picking up soup or from like a bowl. He sort of held it obviously, because the listeners can't see what I'm doing. He sort of like held his glass with two hands, sort of from the bottom and all around the sides, and sort of lifted out rather like a soup bowl. You know, when you're finishing the milk. Yeah. Your cereal.
Yes.
You know, he sort of like drank it like that. So it was quite
horrifying to see.
It was.
And it follows on, to continue the watery metaphor, continues on from the fact that he used two hands to lift up a little plastic bottle of water and drank it in the most odd way. Now, a lot of people are saying in the US that this is classic degenerative condition behavior. It's something that people who suffer from dementia habitually do. It's like when you get really old and suffering from dementia, you go back to your childhood. It's in a way what a child would do.
Okay, yeah, that makes sense. Yeah,
you know, I have by the grace of God many small children, and what he did was what my littlest children do when they're picking up a glass, cupping their hands around it like, as you say.
It is like a
child. It was a bowl of soup, yeah.
And it is, and he slurs his speech as well. And he apparently doesn't drink. So I think I actually believe that he doesn't drink.
I do believe he doesn't drink. That's not to say no other noxious substances cross his lips or his nostrils. I've got no evidence to suggest that. But he often acts as if he's high.
Yeah, I think definitely more of like a stoner than being on sort of anything else, anything sort of that makes you a bit more excited
allegedly,
and concentrated.
Allegedly, we should say. But the reality is that if it's not drunkenness, it's something else. And the slurring of his words, and not just any words, he actually asked God to bless the United States of America.
Yeah,
in his,
that was
it was quite weird and chilling.
Mm. I think Diane Abbott maybe has the same thing though, because you ever see her hands. So some people think that she's got dementia, and then other people think that she's an alcoholic, because if you ever see her hands, they really do shake whenever she gives a speech. And obviously in those sort of car crash interviews running up to the election, she didn't have a clue on some of them. I thought she sort of like slurred her speech. And if you sometimes on the dispatch box, you see her hands like shaking. So, but I mean, politics is an incredibly stressful job. Like, you've seen the way that sort of presidents and prime ministers age, or, you know, politicians in general age.
Well,
I was looking at
Theresa May. Well, this one hasn't aged. I was looking at Theresa May coming out of Downing Street today.
Yeah.
And I was really struck by how just a year of office has affected her. I mean, she looked ravaged, you know, her face, bags under her eyes and so on. I know she's got a lot on her plate, but...
Yeah.
She doesn't look like the woman that entered Downing Street, put it that way.
No.
Doesn't sound like it either, if you ask me.
No, they never do. Blair as well, when he left, he looked awful.
He was like the picture of Dorian Gray, you know.
I think Thatcher managed to escape it, despite only having 4 hours sleep a night. I thought she, obviously it's really sad.
And she drank a lot. She drank a lot of whiskey. Don't have to say allegedly, saying to my producer, because she's gone and dead women can't sue. But I can tell you from having been around her over that period that she really liked drink. Hard drink, you know, whiskey and spirits in general.
So did Dennis as well.
It wasn't a Prosecco that...
No.
but she only did sleep 4 hours a night and... Mm. She did quite well on that 4 hours. Anyway, we're digressing. Back to the water.
I don't think I can link this last one. I think I think I'm going to have to give up. It's a former Pentagon UFO official, because people actually have that title, says that we're not alone, and that he has compelling evidence. When he was sort of working at the Pentagon, he had shown this compelling evidence that we're not alone, and that these aircrafts that displayed characteristics that were not currently in the US inventory, or in fact any other inventory in the world, were spotted. I think that's quite...
Well, look, they had no wings, they had no rotor. They had, it seemed to be a capsule-like thing, without tail, without wings, without rotor, no obvious means of locomotion, and travelling at a speed that is inconceivable for us at this point in time on Earth. You know, my mind is not closed to these things. Mm-hmm. I don't think any of ours should be. I just put it to you that if there are extraterrestrial spacecraft coming here, they must be coming from a higher form of society.
Yeah.
Coming from worlds that voted for Labour governments, which became socialist governments, because only a socialist government could develop the potential of the... Where am I going with this? No,
well, that certainly didn't happen between America and the USSR.
No.
The Americans definitely won that. So I think when it comes to the space raids, capitalism definitely wins.
Well, but for a time, it looked like Khrushchev was right. They were going to bury them. Now, the good news, by the way, Sophie, is that our friends have found...
Oh, the clip. Okay.
The noise of the orgy. Shall we hear it? And give us time to comment on it, will you, once you've played it? Thank you. Listen to this. I've never heard such a thing, I must say.
It's like quite a vibrating sound.
Yes. Moving swiftly on, that's the Gulf of Mexico fish orgy, which, believe it or not, Sophie brought to my attention and the attention of the nation this evening. But she is the programs director of the Entrepreneurs Network and a very smart woman she is too. Now, on the UFOs, just to complete that point, this was a unit set up in secret by the Pentagon, and under the tutelage of a very senior senator, Harry Reid. He's not, a Johnny-come-lately or a here-today, gone-tomorrow. He was in the Senate, I think, for well over 30 years. He's retired now, but now that he's retired, he's talking about it. And he says that he's quite clear about it. There is life on Mars, as it were. There is extraterrestrial life out there. It's hard to overstate or exaggerate the importance of that news, if true, isn't it?
Yeah, I think so. And there's also that big object flying through space at the moment that people are sort of unsure. I think it's they're sort of unsure whether it's a UFO or whether it's sort of it is just like a big piece of I think it's called like the cigar. I think that's what we've called it, floating through space. I think I don't know if I'd want. I think I'd probably like kidnap the UFOs, like if I was in charge, because I don't think I'd want the UFOs going back to wherever they came from to sort of tell people about
how
our
bad
world.
We are.
Yeah, exactly. So I don't.
If they knew how bad we were,
they'd exterminate us. I think that's what would happen.
Well, the Daily Mail would get a petition up to keep these immigrants out, wouldn't they? These green people coming over here, taking our women, taking our jobs. I mean, there would be bound to be that kind of hue and cry. I think the Martians would cry if they gazed upon a world in which a very small handful of people own half of the wealth of the world, and the poorest half of the world go short of water, amongst other things.
Well, I think they definitely take what they watch David Attenborough's Blue Planet and think, what on earth are they doing to their oceans?
Well,
so, but thank God for Michael Gove, because he's going to put a stop to that. So.
Michael Gove, our saviour, said no one, ever, anywhere. Sophie, it's been a pleasure talking with you, Programmes Director of the Entrepreneurs Network. Thank you for taking us across what is trending. Now, I've just made a documentary film about far-right extremism in Britain and the terrorist fringe of that far-right. I've just been called on Twitter, rather alarmingly, by someone who calls himself Game Hunter, a race traitor. Long time since I've heard that kind of language, a race traitor. And I forwarded it to the police because, of course, these kind of things can sometimes be a harbinger of potential harm to come. And we've just heard on the news about the assault on Raheem Sterling by someone who grinned in court when they were being sentenced, which seems to me to suggest the sentence wasn't severe and condign enough. But there's more than one form of terrorism, of course, and over the last few years, 10, 15 years, we have seen a steady, dreadful drip of Islamist, extremist, terrorist violence and plots. In fact, far more plots than incidents. The police and the security services in Britain are stretched sometimes to breaking point, and sometimes they make very, very serious mistakes, like in the case of the Manchester Arena terrorist attack. In the Manchester Arena just earlier this year. Sometimes they get it absolutely right and they foil plots that would otherwise have led to carnage. Now, several people are under arrest from Sheffield and Chesterfield for an alleged plot to cause such carnage at Christmas. And so I wanted to talk to terrorism specialist Simon Trundle about what's behind the story. Simon, thanks for joining us.
Good evening, George. Good to hear you.
Now, we can't go into the alleged perpetrators of this plot, but have you any idea what the plot itself seemed to involve?
Well, if we look at the resources put against it, we're looking at the explosives ordnance disposal team being heavily involved. And that's both on looking at devices, potentially suspect devices.
So it was a bombing rather than a car crash or knifing like some of the others?
Well, they brought in the forensics team with the explosives in order to and they'd only do that if they felt that it was a substance of interest. And it's an intelligence-led operation because of the timing of it and the way they've managed to capture four of them, and there may be a linked arrest at Stansted on Tuesday when they arrested a gentleman travelling on a Swedish passport who arrived on the first flight in the morning. So it may be coordinated, maybe a separate issue, but it's definitely intelligence-led, and that's, we've got to remember, George, that sometimes that intelligence can come from the local community for the most simplest of concerns, can lead to a bigger picture being drawn.
Absolutely. Now, there were reports of shots being fired in the early hours, around dawn, I think, when one of the raids took place. Would that have been the police firing, or was there fire directed at the police? Do you know?
No, there was reports from next-door neighbours of hearing a large, loud explosion.
Oh, was that an explosion? Forgive me. Yeah.
But in fact, normally when you're going in, if there's any concern about the operatives in the house, the persons of interest in the house having any weapons, you would use a breaching charge in the door, and that's probably what they heard. And then flashbangs to disorientate people as you move through the rooms, because you want to try and incapacitate them so you can arrest them without anybody getting harmed.
Of course, we all have to be on high alert, because if a plot has been foiled here, that doesn't mean there aren't other plots. There are many of these people out to harm us, isn't it?
There are, and if you think about it, 10 years ago, the government would never have been producing a program called Run, Hide and Tell, and we wouldn't be hearing announcements on the railway saying, see it, you know, if you see it, say it, and we'll get it sorted. So all of this is to try and educate the public that there is an ongoing threat, but thankfully most of us will never be involved in it.
Indeed, and it is worth making that caveat, isn't it? We faced a bombing campaign in this country before. Ireland faced a much more severe one, but in this country there was a mortar put through the window whilst the cabinet sat around the table. Great Hall at Westminster was bombed. There were serious attempts made to kill the Prime Minister in Brighton in the Grand Hotel and so on. So we have faced arguably much better organised bombing and terrorist campaigns in the past, and we seem to keep calm and carry on. I'm not so sure, are you, Simon, about the slogan, run, hide and tell? I think when everyone runs, like what happened in Bond Street the other week, you can actually get a problem where it turned out none really existed.
Well, yeah, that was spread panic. That was panic begets panic, because some people heard a noise down below. There were two individuals fighting. People wanted to get away from the individuals who were fighting, and by pushing backwards, it created a backflow in a very busy pedestrian staircase and escalator, and that just led to panic, you know, quick, get out of here. And then people swore that they heard gunshots and swore that they heard explosions, and that's just all the noise around them. So, but basically, if we look at the Charlie Hebdo attack in Paris, if there had been better security at the entrance, they held up a mother returning from a preschool with her child, and there was no way she was not going to open the door and put the code in and let them in. But there was nowhere for them to hide. They were then trapped, because the entrance door was a single way in. There was nowhere for them to hide. They were then in a shooting gallery, anybody inside the offices of Charlie Hebdo. In response to that, the idea is move out of an area. Don't take your iPhone out to start videoing something happening. Just move. So whether it's run or walk, but get away from the area if you sense there's a threat. Don't go towards it. Tell is still valuable, because the number of incidents in the past where people have run and forgotten to call emergency services is quite interesting, because, you know, they don't get the accurate report. They get secondhand reports from somebody who says, I see people running away from Oxford Circus, whereas if one of the people had actually contacted directly. So run, hide, tell, but only tell if you're in a safe place. Get out of the place. Get out of the perceived threat. And only when you're safe, decide to make that phone call.
Now, how many of these potential, I know this is a bit about how long is a bit of a string, but are we talking dozens, scores, hundreds, or thousands of potential terrorists at large in Britain? I tell you why I ask, because it turns out that several hundred people who've been fighting for Al-Qaeda and ISIS in Syria and Iraq have been allowed to come back into this country. There have been a few prosecutions, most of which then fail for complicated political reasons. But how safe should we feel? Are we talking hundreds, thousands, scores, dozens?
Security Services report did, and the Metropolitan Police did note that there were 3,000 persons of interest in the country, of which they have to classify the threat that they pose, and brings it down to a couple of hundred of individuals who would be an active threat and would require active surveillance, because we only have a limited, a finite resource to try and track and trace and follow and detect the actions, every action of up to 3,000 people would turn us into a police state and need vast resources, whereas 200 is already a very large number. And the Manchester bombing issue, the report, the statement you said earlier on about where they missed it, was because although he'd been looked at, although he'd been considered a potential threat, amidst the limited resources and the actions that he was taking, it was said, well, you know, no evidence yet to say he's going to act. And therefore he went to the kind of the B group or the C group, not the A group, for surveillance. And but that happens all the time. It happens in a policing role, it happens in a counter-terrorism role. Mm. They have to prioritize their resources. The trouble we have now is that there are so many people out there determined to act against society, but the resources have to be greater and greater, and we are really dependent on intelligence. If we get intelligence, we can react. If we don't have intelligence, we react to the event rather than to the threat.
Well, you see, some people find that a bit difficult, Simon, because if to be told that your country's intelligence services don't have enough personnel, don't have enough resources, in the middle of what, by anybody's standards, is an ongoing terrorist threat, is very difficult to accept when money is found for other things. I talked about one last week on my show. Mrs. May went to Brussels and wrote a cheque for £100 million to counter Russian disinformation campaigns in the Baltic states and the Ukraine. Now, that may or may not be a noble cause, but it doesn't compare in its nobility with the requirement to protect our own people at home. And I got to thinking, indeed I wrote about it, £100 million would have paid for a fair increase in the intelligence services.
Yes, that's true, but believe it or not, at the moment it's not necessarily the money that's lacking. It takes time. If you look at the issue of the armed police officers, armed response officers, there's a shortfall to be filled there, but it takes time to train them. The money's available, the officers have to volunteer for the training, and then they have to go through extensive training. So even if you handed $100 million tomorrow to policing, it takes time to deliver the results. The same with the intelligence service, it takes time to train up analysts, to train up people, to bring them to the level where they can begin to detect the patterns and the algorithms and the threats from individuals. And so it's not necessarily just about money at the moment. It is about the skill set. And that has been extensively developed both in the police and security services at the moment, where they have recruited, they are training. And I presume we will see the bounty of that, the benefit of that in the next coming years. But at any stage in this whole process, George, we could end up with so many threats that the resources are lacking because we lack the knowledge. And I can put that back to Northern Ireland, where I work, did extensive work myself, where the peace process came about, people retired from the police, the intelligence-led operation was reduced, and then we have distant IRA coming back, and we have these authentic IRA coming back, and the others coming back, and we have to rebuild the intelligence on the ground. So there's always this balance that has to be found.
Pleasure talking to you, Simon. Thanks very much for joining us. Simon Trundle, terrorism specialist. I'll have something more to say about what Simon said. Peter has texted, Mr. Galloway, the government are using the same format that is used against the USA war veterans. Delay, deny and hope the Brexiteers die, says Peter in Glasgow. Indeed, some of them openly speculate about death as a factor in this whole affair. Another text, this one from Minnie. How can Remainers get away with saying we didn't know what we were voting for? If they think there were valid arguments, I don't. It was their job to inform us. Good point. Christina says, are we going to lose EHIC when we come out of the EU and have to purchase expensive private medical insurance when we travel in EU countries? Well, that depends on the negotiations. It's perfectly possible for the British to offer free medical treatment, at least for emergencies, not long-term necessarily, to EU citizens in return for EU governments offering the same to our people. That's something for negotiation. Kasif says UFOs are countries around the world testing new technology and new fighter planes. Maybe so. Maybe so. I wanted to just comment on something that Simon Trundle said, because we didn't get time before the break to canvass it. Of course, I acknowledge and accept that in any economic situation, never mind a period of austerity, there are going to be pressures on budgets. The question is what you prioritise then. And as it's the first duty of the state to protect its citizens, it ought not to be that difficult a judgment to make that that policing and intelligence require the budgets that they need. It's not really a question of whether we can afford it or not. It's whether we spend it on that or on something else. I gave you one example of Theresa May's largesse, writing a cheque, I kid you not, for £100 million to the Baltic states and the Ukraine to counter, this is just from Britain, to counter, quote, Russian disinformation campaigns in their countries. Now, I happen to think that that's a canard. I happen to think that that is an absolute red herring. But even if you disagree with me, even if you think there are Russian disinformation campaigns in the Baltic states, what does that have to do with us? At least in a situation where our intelligence services tell us that they need more resources. Now, I take Simon's point that you can put in money, but it takes time to recruit and train people. And that's what I want to turn to for a moment with your indulgence. I have been writing and saying for some time that we need far, far more people in the domestic intelligence service, MI5. We need them to be smarter, and smart they were not, notwithstanding Simon's plucky defence of them in the Manchester Arena case. I'm afraid that doesn't really hold much water if you read the recent report on that particular case. So they need more. They need better, smarter, but I'll tell you something else they need. And nobody ever answers me on this, and I keep saying it. We need an MI5 that has enough brown faces and black faces in it, and a little less, a little fewer Eton collars. We need an intelligence service that knows the communities in which they are operating and seeking to find information and track down potential criminals, because that's what they are, potential murderers, potential mass murderers. It doesn't get much more important than that. And it stands to reason that an Oxbridge fellow whose school background is Eton or one of the other great public schools, I mean no disrespect to them in this, are of limited efficacy. If you're going to hang around, say, the areas of Birmingham where there have been a lot of terrorist cases, or Sheffield, where this latest case is coming from, well, you need not stand out like a sore thumb. You need not to be talking in received pronunciation with your Eton and Oxford slip showing. We need people who look like, sound like, and can understand the communities in which they are seeking out these terrorists. That seems to me obvious. But there's no sign of it. At least no one's ever told me, privately or publicly, in Parliament or out of it, that that kind of prioritisation is going on in the recruiting drive. Now, a not unconnected issue is something else I want to talk about, taking us up to the news. There was a hashtag in the week, for the older people listening. A hashtag is something that then trends on Twitter. The hashtag was hashtag a very Muslim Christmas, which was then promptly hijacked by the kind of idiot who's now deleted his tweet, but unfortunately for him, it has been well photographed and is in the hands of the Metropolitan Police, calling me a race traitor. This hashtag a well-meant and sincere one was hijacked by sundry fascist and foaming at the mouth Islamophobe racists and turned into something quite different. So I wanted to tell you something that I'm in a good position to tell you. I am an elected parent governor in a school which is majority Muslim in London. And I attended, somewhat to my surprise, I must tell you, I was surprised to get the invitation. I attended their nativity play, celebrating the birth of Jesus, venerating his mother, Mary, talking about the stable in which he had to be born, there having been no room at the inn, doors slammed in Mary and Joseph's face, treated like immigrants, shunned as the other. That's what the nativity play was about. And I suppose unusually in Britain, the Arabs in the play were, in this case, actually Arabs. And the piety, the sincerity, the beauty with which they enacted the birth of Jesus, it brought a tear to my eye. And I've got to tell you something. Most of the children in the nativity play were Muslims. And most of the parents in the audience were also Muslims. Almost all of the Muslim women there were visibly Muslim. In other words, they were wearing a hijab. And they were cheering their children's depiction of the birth of Jesus in a stable and venerating his mother Mary with a piety and a passion which, frankly, none of these racist mutts could ever, ever muster. They probably haven't been in a church for decades. They know and care nothing about Jesus and what he stood for. They are wicked and evil, yes, but above all, they are ignorant and stupid. Hashtag a very Muslim Christmas. Yes, Muslims love Christmas, love Jesus, love Mary. In fact, Mary is mentioned more often in the Quran than she is in the Bible. Just think about that. Just think about that. Well, have I got a story for you? Well, we've kind of trailed it heavily in advance. Now, a couple of days ago, I hadn't thought about UFOs for many a year, although on my Talk Sports show, we used to regularly have the British equivalent of what turns out to be a full cell inside the Pentagon that's been operating in secret for a long time and, remarkably, had concluded already some time ago that there are, in fact, UFOs. There is life on Mars or somewhere else, and that life has visited us. Their stories were accompanied by some astonishing video of what appeared to be, though may not have been, one of the aforementioned otherworldlies that were visiting this planet. So who better to ask about it but Andy Lownd, who's the UK Planetary Society chief. Andy.
Hello. How are you going?
Are you with us in this ether, in this world?
Oh yes, just about. I think so.
Now, I'm not someone who is given to believing these kind of things, though I've always said I never rule out that there's life elsewhere in the universe. Would seem, as a matter of simple logic, unlikely that there was none. I'm even open to the possibility that there's more than one universe. I certainly know lots of people who appear to live in a parallel universe. my mind is open. But it was tilting a bit when I read some of these stories, the Harry Reid story and his unit that he set up. Where do you stand? Where does the Planetary Society stand on all this?
Well, it's interesting because I think what we've had is quite interesting. We've had, of course, the announcement that there was this organisation within the Pentagon studying unidentified flying objects, assuming they were probably technology that was from other countries, which is what they were studying at. Then we've had the release of three videos, which is quite remarkable, looking at the videos, which, to be quite honest, when you start looking at them, are quite inconclusive as to exactly what they are. And we need also to ascertain the technical details of the videos, and we need actually independent corroboration of how the videos are actually taken, which we still haven't been given. So there's an issue there from a scientific point of view. Plus, we've got at least one individual who's come forward to actually speak. But again, we have to take this with a pinch of salt, because you can't just rely it on one individual.
No. Who was that individual, Andy? He was a military officer, wasn't he?
Exactly. But we've had all sorts of people come forward before saying who and what they were. And we can't just put a title to somebody and say, oh, obviously they know what they're talking about, because we still need that evidence put forward.
No, of course. But, I mean, if you know, John Doe says he was abducted by aliens on the way home from a pub, that's one thing. But if a military officer says it, and it was his job to be monitoring it, you've got to put a little bit more weight on that.
It puts a bit more credence to it, I must admit. But we still would like to, from our point of view, from a scientific point of view, we'd like to see the evidence put right in front of us and get independent corroboration of these things, which you need to do. And the old rule with any journalism is three independent sources to be really certain.
I'm afraid that rule was abandoned in journalism long ago, Andy.
We still apply it in science, I'm afraid.
I'm glad someone's still applying it, yes.
Yeah, I do think it's quite interesting, and the videos are actually quite fascinating videos which have come out.
Tell us about them.
Well, the videos are quite interesting because they seem to be forward camera footage of American fighter aircraft chasing an object in the sky, and the pilots, if the recordings are correct, don't know what they're chasing or indeed really can't identify what the objects are themselves. And they are quite interesting footage, again, without having hard data to have a look at the footage itself, the raw material. We can't be certain what we're looking at, but it does appear that they are chasing an unidentified flying object.
And they reported it as having accelerated at a pace that is inconceivable. Yes. For Earth-based craft.
A known model of aircraft, which actually is interesting because it actually matches the observations made by other people who've seen such objects before. I mean, I've interviewed a couple of people as well, and they said the acceleration of these aircraft were quite remarkable. But we're still down to the bottom line here is whether or not these things are originally here or originally from somewhere else. And it is quite interesting that this individual has leaned towards the possibility that, yes, we are being visited by extraterrestrials, which I find quite a fascinating statement to be made by an ex-military person. Absolutely fascinating.
Indeed. And also, Harry Reid is certainly not a political friend of mine, but nobody would describe him as a crank.
No, absolutely
as a crank
not.
Caller. He was a very, very senior member of Senate.
That's why
he got that job of setting this unit up.
Exactly.
He also has said that it's official that there are extraterrestrials.
Yeah, well, when you say the term official, we've got to be really careful here. We haven't had anyone put that on the piece of paper formally and saying, yes, they're definitely there. We've still got a group of individuals coming out saying it who work within these groups. But you've also got to remember, we've also got Nick Pope, of course, who worked with the British.
I used to interview him regularly on Talk Sport, yeah.
Very interesting man, Nick Pope.
Yes.
He was there with the Ministry of Defence. And then you watch him on TV these days doing a variety of programmes.
Yes.
And you're thinking,
he's branched out.
Are you really being serious, Nick?
Yes.
You know? So you've got to be a little bit cautious. Once this becomes a popularist thing, and once it becomes, oh, this is interesting, I can get on the radio here, I can get on the TV, oh, I can get a book out of this. Then you start leaning to be, ooh, let's be really careful here.
Mm.
Because then those old rules of journalism suddenly get flown out the window.
Yeah.
And then you start appealing to the populist demand, which, I mean, everybody thinks sometimes I'm quite boring with this, but sorry, we have to have hard evidence in front of us before we could turn around and say, yes, we can confirm that. And it would be nice to have the scientific community, an international body of scientists, together to look at this. The International Astronomical Union probably are as good as anybody to sit down, give them the evidence, let them have a look at it and peer group review it in a good scientific way, and then we could get a decent answer.
Well, your punctiliousness is to be commended, but would it be fair to say this at least, that the case that there may be life on Mars or beyond it is just that little bit stronger today than it was last week before all this news emerged?
Well, I think life in the universe generally would be quite happy to say that anyway. But I think, I have to do it with evidence. I mean, I find fascinating about this is, one, they've admitted this department existed. Two, you suddenly had people coming out with three videos and starting, you know, quite, as you said, quite senior people, not cranks here, coming out and making these comments. That in itself is quite a remarkable thing. And I almost think, are we waiting for yet another shoe to drop here, which could be interesting?
Yes. I mean, sometimes these things are floated, if you'll forgive the pun, as kites,
yes,
to get some more budget.
Yes.
But this unit has been closed down.
Yes, it has.
So it isn't about that. Sometimes it might be a preparation for telling us that Donald Trump is an extraterrestrial and that he's being placed under arrest as an interloper from the planet Zog.
I think that would be more likely, really.
Eureka! Eureka! We've solved it, Andy.
As I said, it's from our point of view, for the possibility of intelligent life visiting this planet.
Oh, well, that rules out Donald Trump.
The evidence still isn't there that we could stick in front of a judge. The other thing is, can we stick it under a judge, and could a jury then look and go, oh, yes, absolutely. And we still don't have that. And I think if we do have this gathered evidence here, which these are talking about, it should be put into international scrutiny from groups of scientists to do the old peer group review thing. It sounds boring, but that is the way we really do need to do this properly. Because bearing in mind, if it turns out, yes, this is right, this is the most incredible thing in the history of mankind.
Yes, indeed. It doesn't get any bigger than that. Andy Lund, UK Planetary Society, I'm grateful to you for giving us your expertise and your skepticism. Scouser Lard says, I'm about to set off in heavy traffic. My journey will now be very enjoyable with George Galloway doing the Drive Time show. I do like this Drive Time show, I must say, and it seems to be going down quite well, at least amongst Twitter users. So thanks for that, Scouser Lard. And here's a tweet from the wisest man in Christendom. He's Samson in Kilmarnock. He says, evening, George. On which other radio show can you find the host making such highbrow jokes with references to Posada? To quickly correct your wonderful guest, though, the state sector was the driving force in the US space program. The private sector couldn't profit from it. Socialism took us to the moon. What a wonderful observation, and absolutely correct. And on another night, I'll tell you who Posadas was. His group believed that there were UFOs, and that was proof that socialism had triumphed in these far distant worlds, because only the socialist plan of production could develop the economy to such an extent to make extraterrestrial travel possible. You can laugh, but actually there's a germ of truth in it, as Samson just pointed out. If it were not for public expenditure, the state directing the economy, there would have been no space travel in the United States. And moreover, the only reason there was because the then Soviet Union sent Sputnik orbiting the world. The then Soviet Union put the first dog in space, monkey in space, the first man and woman in space. The Soviet Union led the space race, and the United States state had to respond to it. So he's right. If it had been left to American capitalism, no rocket would ever have left the ground. Ragnar says, an interesting discussion about aliens, George. However, it's nothing new. Aliens have been here for thousands of years. Read any religious text using modern words to describe space instead of heaven. Star of Bethlehem as not just a star, but a UFO. How interesting. And Charlie Tater says, loving a bit of Gorgeous George on talk radio. Thank you, Charlie. Very kind of you. And here's an SMS from Alex in Edinburgh. Hi, George. So people did not know what they were voting for. If they knew what they were voting for in any general election, we would never have a Tory government. The people get the government they deserve. Sad, but true. Well pointed out, Alex in Edinburgh. The problem is you wouldn't buy a used car from Boris Johnson and the other joker, Michael Gove, would you? Notwithstanding he's rescuing our oceans, according to Sophie earlier. And if Liam Fox was going door-to-door, you'd lock up your loved ones, wouldn't you? Nick is in Slough and wants to talk about homelessness. Go ahead, Nick.
Hi, George. How you doing, mate?
I'm good, sir. Go ahead.
I want to talk about the homelessness crisis, which is being described as a national disgrace.
Yes.
And rightly so.
And didn't Theresa May cast doubt on that at Prime Minister's question? Didn't she say they weren't really homeless?
Yeah, I've only seen a little bit of that. Something to do with a child.
Yes.
I'm not too sure what she says. I don't really...
You don't hang on her every word, Nick.
I've only seen bits or clips on the radio that you put up earlier, so I'm not too sure. I can't really comment too much.
Okay.
But I believe she spoke about child homelessness and said they're not necessarily on the streets, but I haven't looked too much into it.
Yeah.
But let's leave May alone for a minute. But look, you know, it is a national disgrace because we're nearly in 2018. We're the fifth richest country on the planet, apparently.
Sixth, I think it is now.
Oh, sixth, so probably seventh next year.
Still pretty rich.
We shouldn't be having these problems, George. Now, I just want to see what your thoughts and what the listeners' thoughts are to my solution to this homelessness crisis.
Okay.
Now, I don't know if this has been mentioned before. Correct me if it has. I'm sure you will, George. But at the moment, we have got these great big buildings that are only occupied up to 7 hours a day. The other 17 hours in that day, they're totally empty. 2 days a week, they're totally empty. Now, what I'm on about is schools. And, you know, you got 2 weeks. They've just broken up now. These schools are going to remain empty for at least 2 weeks whilst we've got many people homeless. So I don't understand why this has not been thought of before to try and put homeless people into schools, especially over the Christmas period where it's freezing temperatures. And like I said, these schools are going to be totally empty for at least 2 weeks. And I mean, mentioned about the 6 weeks during the summer holiday, the 2 weeks on Easter, the days off they have off in between. Should this not be looked into for even a temporary measure or a permanent measure?
As an emergency measure, it has much to commend it. There are probably more suitable buildings, large empty office blocks and so on, that are not being utilised for this purpose. And I've often thought of that as I see driving around London, for example, vast acres of unused office accommodation and other post-industrial and warehouse accommodation where the businesses have closed down. And that would not in any way interrupt the children's work and their workspace and might be a better solution. But you're right to think of emergency solutions, but it's actually relatively easy to solve the problem of homelessness if you're serious about doing it. Well, you have to build houses and you have to build, I'm for the return of prefabricated housing for the bottom of the market, if you like. We could construct, as we did in the war and after it, we could construct good quality.
But like you say,
prefabs.
Is there any need for this whilst we do have these great big buildings that are unoccupied for most of the day? Now, I was going to comment on these empty office blocks and so on, but I was under the impression that these are privately owned, therefore wouldn't even make it past the first stage, whereas schools are...
That wouldn't stop me. That wouldn't stop me, Nick.
No. It wouldn't stop me either. But I just thought the schools...
I take that point.
Maybe.
I take that point.
Maybe,
You'd have to worry a little bit as to what... damage or potential degradation to the school estate would occur if significant numbers of homeless people were bedding down in their classrooms or their gymnasia and so on. It's not a crazy idea at all. I'm just trying to make the point that emergency solutions are one thing, but we need millions of new houses to bring prices down, to bring rents down, and to bring the housing stock into democratic control. That's why I have advocated all of my life, since I was a teenager, a serious crash building program. Now, some out there may laugh at my idea of prefabs, but I've got to tell you that prefabs, which were a temporary housing solution, lasted well into my young adult life, and the people who lived in them loved them. Loved them more than anyone could ever imagine that they would.
A documentary on that,
because they were like little bungalows with gardens for people who could only have dreamt of living in a bungalow with a garden. And nowadays, with the building technologies that we have, we could make prefabs that are very, very much better than the prefabs were back then. But the first step in all of this is to, as you have done, spark proper debate about it. One thing's for sure, Nick, it cannot be left to the private sector. Building, if you look at the, just down the road, there's the Battersea Power Station development. Battersea Power Station, an iconic part of working class London, has now become, under Malaysian ownership, yet another a gated community for the very, very rich, and the minuscule provision within for so-called affordable housing has been basically scrapped. And even the affordable housing was not affordable for most working class people, but even that has been basically scrapped. So yet another piece of working class London has been handed over to the billionaire developers, in this case from Malaysia, and for millionaires and multi-millionaires to live in, or probably not to live in, just to buy, to have as an appreciating asset. Nick in Slough, it's been marvellous talking to you. Thank you very much indeed for that. Lizzie Fletcher says, I was thinking earlier that I couldn't wait for Friday, mother of all talk shows, and all of a sudden, here you are on Drive Time! Exclamation mark. Thank you, Lizzie, for that. And she recaps on my joke. Intelligent life on Mars, that rules out Trump then. Indeed, it does. Maybe there'll be more on Trump in the final hour. One thing is for sure, there's plenty more coming up on the Mother of All talk shows, which is what I'm calling this, though it's actually me standing in for Delaney Mann, who is a pioneer of campaigning radio. I'm very proud to be sitting in his chair. So coming up, we've got Brexit, we've got UFOs, and we've got Uber. Imagine that. Uber are a taxi company and not an Amsterdam-based app that pays no tax after all. I hate to say I told you so, but I did. I did and I did and I did and I did. And when I said that Uber should be run out of London, and that if I were the mayor of London, they would be run out of London, they all laughed. Oh, how they laughed. But they're not laughing now. People are actually queuing up to kick Uber out, not just of London, but everywhere. There may very well be intelligent life on Mars and beyond, which rules out my theory that Donald Trump is an extraterrestrial. His motor skills, his intellectual skills, all point to him being, well, all very human. And Brexit, where's it going? Is it going anywhere? Are Uber on the way out of town? Tweet me. Or SMS us, as the very wise man in Kilmarnock, Samson, has done again. Hi again, George. According to Shelter, around 1.4 million homes or potentially refurbished buildings are presently lying empty right now. Using schools is a good idea, but not necessary. There is actually a housing surplus. The problem is one of distribution, as many are second homes or belong to property speculators. Samson in Kilmarnock. Good points, well brought out. Now, my next guest has been in joint saddle or harness with me for some time now, as we both sought to highlight the counterfeit taxi company, which claimed it wasn't a taxi company, which said it was cheap, but then only if you don't calculate the accidents and other worse incidents that have occurred more or less daily, certainly weekly, over the course of Uber's brief hegemony in London. He's Lewis Norton, who is the spokesperson for the RMT Union's London Taxi Branch, and he joins me now. Lewis, welcome back, my friend.
Hello, George. How are you doing?
I'm good. The better for hearing from you and the better for hearing the news out of the EU today. Time's running out for Uber, isn't it?
Well, it does appear so. On the European front, this judgment today will classify or has classified Uber as a transportation company as opposed to a digital platform, which they were using to obfuscate and manoeuvre around transport legislation in or any of the 27 member states of the EU. So it is good news for those European states where Uber was operating in that way. But however, for London, I have to say, George, it's business as usual for Uber, as this will not affect their operating model in London and much of the UK.
Quite. It's not just transport legislation that they drive a coach and horses through, if you'll forgive the pun, but labour legislation. The Uber drivers are, or until recently, were held to be self-employed freelancers. They were working for way below the minimum wage, working dangerously long hours, have no access to any toilet facilities and so on. I mean, they were basically modern-day slaves, and their purpose was, apart from making profits for Uber and their investors, but to drive honest, well-trained and reputable taxi drivers, cab drivers as well as black cab drivers, out of business. How successfully have they done that?
Well, I think looking at our city, and I can only talk from a London taxi driver perspective and our members in London, it has significantly harmed the London taxi trade, Hackney carriage trade, in the last, I'd say, 2 years, really, when Uber's took the vice grip of the city by using, as you say, exploited labour practices and loopholes by this definition they are a tech company and not a transport provider, and offering a bogus system of applying for hire, immediate hire service using minicab and private hire legislation. My members and myself, who is a working taxi driver, can say with much certainty that taking salary is more or less two-thirds down, I would say, and it's going to be a very bleak Christmas for a number of licensed qualified taxi drivers in London.
Two-thirds down the wages?
Absolutely, yeah. And I hope some of the members and my comrades out there won't mind us spilling that to yourself, George. But it really is tough times. I mean, we've even got the Mayor, Sadiq Khan, insisting that the city go green and we have to now drive electric taxis, which, of course, from our union's perspective, is a fantastic step forward for the health of Londoners, but a price tag of some £70,000 per unit, it beggars belief how London taxi drivers are supposed to afford this when their working practice are being absolutely railroaded, as you say, a coach and horses being driven through by Uber. And this judgment today, as I said, ostensibly fantastic if you're in one of those member states, but Sadiq Khan, as you and I both know, George, is an ardent Europhile, and he'd like to tout this as a virtue of the EU, but it really isn't. He needs to put his finger out and double down on the legislation and the practices in London and uphold the differential between taxis and private hire. Only him and TfL can do that.
Well, we're still in his beloved EU, and yet London is still not doing as much as the EU now is doing on this Uber virus, I call it, because it has spread through the transport body politic with disastrous results. Even I did not know that black cab drivers' earnings were down two-thirds. My own son-in-law is doing the knowledge at the moment, and he tells me that people lean out of the window and say, the game's dead, mate, you're wasting your time. And from what you say, it's more or less headed that way unless something changes. What is in the offing? The Transport for London seemed to be ready to withdraw their licence. What's happening on that?
Well, again, it's a conundrum that only the Mayor of London can argue, and it seems to be a convenient excuse to hide behind legalities and legislation. And I'll just explain for the listeners that Uber's licence was up for renewal in May, another five-year term. And what Transport for London did was to review that licence. They gave them a six-month extension. In that period, they determined that Uber would not be relicensed. And again, that was back in September, and we were, well, elated by that, and we welcomed it with open arms. But however, due to UK legal procedure, Uber instigated an appeal process, and under that appeal process, they are still able to operate. So we have this kind of bizarre situation where you've got an unlicensed company running around operating in London. Transport for London still granting private hired driver's licenses to individuals to work for Uber, and whilst it's under appeal for public safety. It's utterly bizarre and incredible. And it seems to be, once again, when the licensing authority and the mayor and the establishment want to ignore the nuances in the law, they seem to do that and say, well, not me, Gov, I can't do anything about that, I'm afraid, Mr. Taxi Driver. So again, this is, I have to say, it's incumbent on the mayor, George, to really step in and say, it's a matter of public safety, we are not going to grant Uber to operate under the appeal process, and they must rescind that licence immediately.
Rescind it immediately and let them appeal. And if the appeal wins, then they'll obviously be reinstated. But the idea that you can continue to operate your business whilst two bites of the cherry have been taken by TfL, which ought to have put them on the suspended list, is just ridiculous. It shows a complete lack of resolve, to put it at its best.
It is a complete lack of resolve, to put it at its best. I mean, you've got to also look in the round without going down. Look, me and you could talk about this all day, George, and I'm sure your listeners may not appreciate that, but we have the Uber CEO flying into London and holding meetings with the mayor that we are told are going very productive. However, this is a company that has gone on record, that we've found in the press recently, of losing millions of its users' data. You know, it's been leaked onto the dark web. We've seen the sexual assaults rising from the drivers where Uber have not taken or exercised due diligence to vet their drivers. We've seen the myriad and utter smorgasbord of crashes and terrible driving we've seen. And yet the mayor still is utterly unconvinced that this is not much of a problem and doesn't really need much redress immediately. Incredible.
Isn't their business model now shot through the court decision, the tribunal decision, that they must grant holidays and pay the minimum wage, the EU decision that they're a transport company, not a low-tax Amsterdam app? Isn't their business model now being broken up piece by piece? Won't these events inexorably lead to the company going out of business?
Well, one would hope that the company drastically needs to revise its model, or, as you say, it will eventually go out of business. I think the one silver lining from this ECJ ruling is that it takes away Uber's defence, if they were to have any, that, as you said, they are just a transport company, and that does play into the idea that where we're going after workers' rights for the drivers, Uber can't hide behind this facade that they are not a transport company, and then they're not putting drivers and passengers in contact for that purpose. And the same goes also for the act that the vehicle's applying for hire and the driver's applying for hire. Uber can no longer say that we're not part of the regulatory framework that governs Hackney Carriage Law because we are a tech provider. However, I must stress again, though, George, these weren't ever put in the UK by Uber. Uber have always abided by the legislation, ostensibly, and gone through the regulatory hoops. They jumped through them. But what they have found is loopholes in that regulatory framework, which need to be sealed up by our state and by our Transport for London.
Well, I'd like to wish you a good Christmas, Lewis, but it doesn't sound like it's going to be a great Christmas for the taxi trade. Two-thirds down as a result of Uber. I wish you all the best on a personal level, pal, as you know. And if they'd listened to us, none of this would ever have happened. That's Lewis Norton, who's the branch secretary of the RMT Union London Taxi Branch. Now, here's an SMS. Says Uber won't be out of town if Chris Grayling has anything to do with it. His reply, when asked about the cuts to local buses, was that it could be possible to be replaced by Uber-style services. Atrocious reply, basically saying, get a taxi. during a meeting with Lord Porter. Let them eat cake, said Marie Antoinette. And Andrew Spears says Branson is the new Uber, affecting the NHS with cheap services and paying slave wages and getting compensation off Maybot. I was talking to someone today about this extraordinary business where Sir Richard Branson's Virgin Health Group didn't get their contract renewed, didn't get it renewed, and he then sued that health service trust for the non-renewal of his contract, which it was in the trust's gift to renew or not to renew. And I don't know what the outcome was, but the doctor I was talking to today seemed to think that he picked up millions of pounds from an already starving NHS. Good old Richard. Here's Ken in Luton. Go ahead, Ken.
Good evening, George.
Good evening to you, sir. What would you like to say?
I think we've got a bit of civil disobedience because they're just running it through, and we're not going to get Brexit if we leave it to that lot.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, when you look at it, George, there was only one person in the House of Lords that ever stuck up for us when they had the debate. A week after we voted to come out, everyone was shouting, like Min Campbell and the Labour woman and a Conservative. And Nigel Lawson said, there'll be trouble if you try and do that. And they turned around and said, they will get the biggest lawyers in the land to reverse this decision. And yet, you know, they're not going to do it, mate. I'll tell you that much now, unless we have a bit of civil disobedience.
Well, I'll tell you what, Ken, that you, in one sense, you have to admire their cheek. They never accepted a decision made by 17.4 million people in Britain, the largest number of people to vote for any proposition, any party, any politician in the entire history of this country. They decided that they would not accept it, and they have been moving their pieces around. If you imagine this as one of these toy soldier battlefields, they have been moving their pieces around, their artillery here, their infantry there, their generals here, and they have ruthlessly exploited the fact that they are a machine and the Brexit forces were not. We were a ragtag army of ordinary people, many working class people, some poor people. We were people who had enough resources to fight the campaign and win it, but that was where it ended. The resources depleted, the ragtag army, the mob happy maybe, went home too early, whilst these people have ruthlessly manoeuvred to the position that we're in now. And Ken, it ain't over yet. They're not going to rest until they've killed Brexit.
No, but who are we going to vote for, George? Our Labour candidate, Mr. Shuter, he's an advent Remainer. And yet, 68% of Luton voted to get out.
Well, I'm not allowed to tell you who you should vote for, Ken. Everyone has to make that judgment for themselves. In any case, it'll be some time before the big voting occurs again, if I'm any judge. But there will be by-elections, because there always are. Actuarially speaking, there are always by-elections, although now that MPs generally are younger and healthier than they were before, they don't take place at quite the same rate. But as Nye Bevan once said, where there's death, there's hope, and there will be by-elections. And if the Remainers are unlucky, one or more of these by-elections will be in places precisely where the people voted out and the MP has consistently and continually and until now, until their resignation or demise, had been seeking to frustrate that outcome. Now, were that to happen in such a by-election, the Remainers would be in trouble. That's what I think, Ken. I've just been reviewing some tweets, and I've just seen a tweet about Diane Abbott, and it forces me to address this point. Diane Abbott is the most harassed, insulted, abused on grounds of race and gender politician in this country. Thank God she hasn't suffered any physical attack, but the mental torture of the sheer volume of the racist abuse to which she is routinely subjected, not just at times when she slipped up or made a mistake or whatever, but always and for all the years that social media has existed. And when I hear other people talking about rough treatment that they get on social media or from the public, I normally take it with a bit of a pinch of salt, not least because I was the first MP to be seriously assaulted in the street and nobody in the political class gave a toss about it. I was hospitalised by an attacker for political reasons. He attacked me for political reasons, for statements that I had made as an elected member of parliament. And I warned then when they all ignored it, except when they were laughing at it, because they didn't like me. And by the way, I should say, one of the very, very few exceptions to that rule is the aforementioned Mr. Michael Gove that I've been talking about in a jocular fashion this evening. He was almost the only senior politician to actually stop his car in the street, get out of the car and come across when he saw me sitting at a cafe nursing my wounds, to come across and commiserate. And it would be wrong not to say that. But when the political class as a whole wants to close down social media, it's usually fronted by people who wouldn't recognise a really lousy, foul tweeter if they saw one, because they haven't really, most of them, ever faced that. But Diane Abbott has and does. And the one that's, I'm not going to say what it's about because I oughtn't to draw more attention to it, but it is perfectly foul. And when I saw pictures of someone at a big function bash who was involved in blacking up as Diane Abbott so as to take pictures of it and use for advertising purposes, I couldn't believe my eyes that this happened. It's really, really serious. So from my point of view, and I've known her for more than 30 years, Diane Abbott is a tower of strength. She's a credit to her community and to the people who elect her in overwhelming numbers with greater and greater majorities all the time. Here's some tweets before the news. Andrew Spears, well said, George. Diane has a terrible time and it must stop, as you had to suffer also. And Christina says, I see George Galloway as the Tarzan of the political jungle. Jeremy Corbyn is the king of the jungle, and we need a Tarzan to defend him. Time we had George Galloway back in UK Labour. Thank you, Christina. Andrews, I have read one more then. Spare a thought for those who can't afford a proper taxi and those who work for Uber out of desperation. Uber only have a business model because of inequality. They are the symptom, not the virus. No, the workers are the symptom. Uber are the virus. They are a parasitical virus which is seeking to exploit the reality that you describe. There are buses, there are trains, there are tubes, there are minicabs, and there are black cabs. And they were doing quite a good job until Uber came along and started to put them out of business and into penury, and their travelling public all too often into a danger to public safety. Now, a couple of firsts for me. I did my first trending review. Now I'm about to do my first music roundup of the year with a man who seems to know everything about music. And my music knowledge is, compared to his, rather limited. He's Alexander Milas. Now, MD, what does MD stand for, Alexander?
Well, I'm a director of my little company.
Managing director, of course. And your company is Twin TV?
Twin V, that is.
Twin V. Mm-hmm. And you're a journalist, and you're an all-round sage, I understand.
Once or twice, I've been known to predict a trend, you might say.
Excellent. Now, let me ask you the first and obvious question. I won't go into the politics of it, though I was deeply involved in them a week or two ago. Are the Gallagher brothers really kissing and making up?
I'm going to tell you what, you know, the earth hasn't cracked in two yet, and so I can't say they've actually gotten back together, but they're saying incredibly nice things about each other on Twitter just today, so it seems like hell is thawing, which is a really interesting development, because this is just like the kind of things you don't ever expect to see happen.
I never expected it, especially after Noel came out as a Conservative voter just last week, and calling Jeremy Corbyn a communist when Liam Gallagher thinks rather differently. But I suppose you can be an ensemble, as you can be brothers, and have different political opinions. So what does that mean, that we're going to get an Oasis revival, a tour?
Well, you know, I hate to sound cynical, but I'm going to right now. You know, if the check is big enough, I think anything is possible. As long as they're alive, I think there's always a possibility. I mean, there have been some really notable reunions this year and last that suggest that no beef is too big for a little stint on stage. And what are we really talking about at the end of the day? A few million pounds to stand there for 90 minutes and play songs.
Yeah, you don't even have to talk to each other. Yeah, you don't have to look at each other.
Exactly. It's not the minds, let's put it that way.
There have been many groups. I mean, I think, was it the Everly brothers that really hated each other, weren't brothers anyway? Or was it the Isley brothers? I mean, there have been a lot of people who have been brothers as an ensemble in music, but we're not filled with brotherly love.
No, we're certainly not. But I guess that's what adds to the chemistry of so many of these rock bands, is that very tension. The fact that they despise each other offstage means that when they're on, that's how they get it out. And I think that's what makes what we call rock and roll tick sometimes.
Yeah. Okay, tell us, what else? What are your highlights?
Well, I got to say, it's been a really interesting year, not just for brand new music, but also for reunions as well. I mean, Guns N' Roses, yet another band that people said would never reunite with, you would say, their best original lineup. That happened, and it's been knocking everyone's socks off. Axl's been turning up on stage. They've been selling out stadiums, and by many accounts, it's the best they've ever been, because I guess they're all more or less living healthily these days. And again, this is something that 5 years ago people said flat out could never happen.
Well, I mean, I'll have to take your word for that, because I'm not a fan. Did they have the same kind of fissures within the band?
Oh, I mean, anyone who's read an interview with them over the last 20 years or so has probably seen some serious derision happening, you know? I mean, just like Axl, kind of like a lightning rod for like a universal hatred of Guns N' Roses fans, because, of course, he toured with a bunch of other musicians, not the original lineup.
And did he call themselves Guns N' Roses? This is something always... I mean, I was once just about headed out for a UB40 revival, only to discover that it was not the UB40 I knew and loved.
Yeah. You can't
Keeps the name? Who can portray themselves as being?
You know, it's usually that conversation you have in a bar 20 years ago before you're successful that turns around to bite you all those years later. I mean, Axl toured as Guns N' Roses. I couldn't call them that, though. It was always Axl and Friends in my book. When they reunited, that's when they became Gene Argan, and that's when they became important again, too.
Okay. And now I see a reference to Queen here. Their main man is, of course, in another place. But are Queen still a thing?
Yeah, it was interesting. I saw them headline at Wembley Arena last Friday, actually. And, of course, they play the O2 Arena as well earlier in the week. And a lot of people said it would never happen. It could never work. And I think the reason why it did was because they didn't present themselves as Queen. It was more like a Freddie Mercury tribute concert, which I think was important, because I think rock and metal fans feel very protective over their icons, and I think anything else would have felt exploitative, whereas this felt more like it's an homage to the great man that Freddie was, with Adam Lambert filling in on vocals, if that makes sense.
And how is he as a vocalist, Adam Lambert?
I mean, he's absolutely phenomenal. I mean, there is a moment when the gig is about two-thirds finished, and they actually pipe in some Freddie vocals, and then you just realize, you know, he might hit all the notes, but there was only one Freddie Mercury. I mean, it just cuts you right in two when you hear those notes sung in that way. Although, it has to be said, Adam Lambert is just the consummate showman, and, you know, I can't imagine anyone doing it better.
And have people been rolling up for these performances?
Sell-out gigs, you know. It's a really big time for Queen, obviously. They have this, this big feature film that's coming up next year. Bryan Singer, the director, was just fired a little while ago. So we'll see who actually heads up the rest of the production. But it's an interesting...
Who's playing Freddie, do you know?
Yeah, the guy, I can't remember his name for the life of me. He was the lead actor in a series on Netflix called Mr. Robot. But he looks just like him, which is amazing.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah.
Fantastic. Okay, now let's turn to your albums of the year. I can't say I'd be a customer for any of them, but everyone has the right to their own taste. Talk me through Deep Purple. I thought they had long ceased to exist.
Indeed. Well, I mean, it depends on what you consider Deep Purple. Of course, you know, it's just like, this is like Deep Purple Mark 16.
Oh, is it? Or another, like another of these stories,
but, But, you know, I mean, it's just like, if you were to kind of pick a theme of a lot of what we've been talking about, you have bands that are kind of teetering over the horizon, you know, but they're still making phenomenally interesting and relevant music.
Well, is it interesting and relevant, or just profitable? Are they profiting from nostalgia, or are they doing anything original?
Well, I mean, I think that's a really interesting question, because I think there's a huge amount of nostalgia right now. We're just talking about Queen, for instance, because we're talking about the times of yore, you know, just like when giants strode the earth. And I think 2016 was such a brutal year, seeing so many brilliant talents passing away.
Yeah, it was, really. You know, the Grim Reaper was busy that year.
It really was. It really was. And I think it kind of made a lot of people realize that, you know what, whatever form we can see these bands in, we probably should, because it just won't.
Why not hologram these things? You can do that now.
Well, it's interesting you mentioned that. You know, there's a big furore in the rock and metal world right now because Ronnie James Dio toured as a hologram. Of course, he passed away a few years ago, and yet the band that used to back him up are actually touring as Dio, with him on stage as like this Obi-Wan Kenobi hologram.
See, which, I don't see anything wrong with that. That to me is better. than a stand-in.
Yeah.
And, of course, his family, his estate, will equally benefit from it.
Yeah, I agree. Well, I think there's a touch point of a really interesting debate, you know? I mean, just, like, what is acceptable and what isn't, you know? I think I've never met a musician that wasn't incredibly particular about how they were presented on stage. And so I think at some level you have to at least know that Dio would have wanted it that way, because it feels like it's exploitative any other way. But, you know, I could be wrong. Maybe I'm just a bit old-fashioned or something, but it all feels very new. And
well, we could have these cards, you know, these opt-out cards. I do not want to come back as a hologram.
Yeah, hollow donor cards. Yeah,
hollow donor cards. Look, I need to take a break, but I want to hear some of this Deep Purple. Words you never thought you'd hear me say. We're talking Deep Purple. Ha! Deep Purple. All I've Got Is You, from the album Infinity, is one of Alexander Milas's picks of the year. Let's hear a blast. Now, Alexander, I mean, I never liked that kind of music first time round, so I'm unlikely to like its revival, but clearly plenty of people do. And to my surprise, some of them are quite young. How does that happen? Do they learn it from their mother and father, or what?
Yeah, well, you know, I think definitely there's a kind of a familial influence happening. But also, I mean, you look at the slew of Marvel films, for instance. You know, I mean, Iron Man, fantastic example, introduced a whole generation of kids to Black Sabbath. You know, I mean, and just keeps on happening again and again. Guardians of the Galaxy.
What a good point. Yeah, what a good point. My children are really into Iron Man.
Yeah.
And I hadn't realized that the price of that was that they must get into Black Sabbath.
Yeah, inevitably so. But, I mean, it's definitely true of me. I mean, not to inject my own experience into it, but I would have known nothing about 70s rock and roll if it wasn't for the slew of Vietnam films that came out around the time I was 18.
That. I approve of that.
Yeah, it's good music.
Yeah, definitely. Now, Stephen Wilson was your other pick. I must confess my ignorance. I don't know who Stephen Wilson is. Tell us.
Well, you know, it's interesting that, you know, because I think it kind of speaks to the way that a lot of the mainstream media frequently treats a lot of music like this that sells out arenas or the Royal Albert Hall instantaneously. You know,
really?
it tickled number one on the charts. And yet,
despite, the album charts.
In the album charts.
What does that mean now, though? You know, once upon a time, that meant people went into shops and bought albums. How do you get to the top of the album charts now?
Well, still very much in the same way. I mean, obviously, streaming charts and things like that tell you a lot about people's habits. But, you know, still the most important barometer is how are people actually parting with their money. And so that's why, even though it might not number in the tens of millions the way that it used to, because when a pop record came out, I mean, it just destroyed every time zone. Now that doesn't happen, but it's still an important way of learning about where people are putting their cash, because people tend to vote with their money.
Yeah, of course. Stop. I'm sorry I interrupted you about Stephen Wilson. You were telling us who he is.
Oh, no, no. Well, I mean, he is the front man of a band called Porcupine Tree, but he's a bit of a prog mastermind as well. And this album is really interesting because it's so pop sensible. And it tickled number one on the charts, and it's really, really interesting. And I think it speaks to an important point that a lot of this music seems to exist almost in perpetuity despite any kind of mainstream acknowledgement, which I think says that actually the music fan is really healthy. You always hear all these things about rock is dead and, you know, it just doesn't exist. I think in spite of all these ridiculous pronouncements, it isn't just existing. It's growing as well.
How interesting. Okay, the album's To the Bone. The track is Nowhere Now. Let's hear it. It is luminous observed.
But we never learn. We just make it worse.
Nice voice. I quite approve of that one.
Oh, good news.
Now, are Hawkwind really still blowing?
Hawkwind are really still going. It's incredible. You know, and I think, again, they've just been resistant to time in so many ways. And they're still doing interesting things. You know, they're not just repeating a template, but they're actually coming up with new sound, which is really...
there must be quite an age now.
A little bit, you know. But, you know, Dave Brock, you know, lives out, I think, towards Somerset it is. And, you know, I mean, he works on a farm, you know. I mean, just like, you know, he gets up with the dawn, you know, he goes to bed at sunset. And... you know, he's not just making music all day. You know, he's doing backbreaking labor. And I think there's something to say about that. It's not just good for the soul. I think it keeps you going as well.
I mean, how old can you go? I mean, I mean, Mick Jagger can still dance and the Rolling Stones can still pack them in. Is there an age at which it will become positively ridiculous? I mean, could Mick Jagger be on the stage in his 80s?
Yeah, I think it's completely positive that's happening, though, you know, because I think that's inspirational. I mean, I think that a lot of ideas about age, I think, are, you know, kind of unfair, you know, because it's all about rules about what you should be doing and what you shouldn't be doing.
Now you're talking, Alexander. I'm with you on that. Let's hear a bit of Hawkwind. Have you seen them? From the album Into the Woods. Hawkwind, still blowing, and working on a farm in Somerset. Now, your last pick was Robert Plant. I know that he's still going. I see his posters up around the place. Tell us about that.
Well, I mean, I think it's, again, we're talking about, you know, whether artists, you know, who are, you know, probably 30, 40, 50 years in their career can still make important music. I think Robert Plant is proof that you can. You know, I mean, as we learned from the Stairway to Heaven infringement case that happened the other year, I mean, when you were in a band that made a single song that's worth over $500 million, which is how much they assess that song was worth, and yet you don't go back to it because you want to go and make new things and not just play old things.
I approve of that. Yeah.
I think that makes it worth listening to. In an episode.
What happened on that case? I've forgotten.
Well, I mean, I think, you know, there was a settlement and, you know, they walked away. But, you know, it was unfortunate, you know, because I think a lot of people, they could hear the similarities. You know, and I guess it's just one of those things where if it had been seen to maybe 20 years ago, I think people would have been less cynical about the claim, perhaps. But, you know, what was interesting was to see them total just how much that song is actually worth. I mean, probably one of the best played, best loved Led Zeppelin songs of all time, but I mean that figure is staggering, and not to tap in says something about a man's integrity when they don't actually go back to that. They just want to make new music in the studio.
Yeah, I mean, usually people do a mix, don't they? I went to an Elvis Costello concert a year or so, maybe two ago, and he had the perfect eclectic mix of new and standards. It is important if you go to a concert that you hear things that you recognize and already like, but it must be leavened, mustn't it,
with absolutely.
New music.
Yeah, I mean, to acknowledge legacy is not to be crushed by it, you know, and I think that balance is important to strike, and I think most good artists manage to do that somehow, even if they have to begrudgingly play the old hits sometimes.
Yeah.
You know, in order to grow, they have to bring the new stuff in as well.
So, in summary, what's your take on the contemporary music scene as we come to the end of 2017?
Well, you know, we played a lot of really classic or, you know, heritage bands, we could call them, you know, just because there's a lot of vibrant music being created there. I think my take on the contemporary music scene is simply that major labels, you know, continue to treat mainstream consumers like idiots and, you know, sign artists that, you know, perhaps they're making glorified nursery rhymes in some ways, you know. You know, I don't want to sound anti-pop. I just think what pop music has become is just sort of produced and insincere. And that's a real shame. It's a terrible statement on what people think of music fans, because I think there's a lot more to them.
I mean, music endures and will always, I think, endure. I mean, my child, 3 and a half, not even 3 and a half, is crazy for music. He's crazy for dancing to music. He has favorites. And he didn't actually get that from us, but he is. I mean, music is eternal, isn't it?
Absolutely. You know, I mean, not to get too deep for the moment, but, you know, I do a bit of charity work with Nordoff Robbins, who do music therapy. And I watched this incredible story about a young girl, you know, who was blind, had never seen anyone dance. And they were using music to treat, you know, her condition. And she just began dancing spontaneously. She'd never seen someone do it. And then suddenly she just began doing it. And I just thought, wow. Well, that was magical.
That is magical, yeah. So what should we look forward to in 2018? Any big things going to happen?
Oh, my gosh. Well, you know, I got to say, an Oasis reunion.
Well.
You heard it here first. Yeah. I'm going to be watching that space.
Well, I mean, that will be very big news, won't it?
Indeed.
I mean, because it's not like they were 40 years ago.
No, certainly not.
There's still people are alive and kicking that were going to their concerts.
Yeah, and you just want to go to see the show, not just to hear the music, but just to see if a fight's going to erupt on stage.
Well, yes, and to wear the parkas, although they rubbish the parkas now, or at least Noel did. Apart from Oasis, then, what else?
Well, I mean, there's so many fantastic festivals. What's interesting is how many boutique and unique festivals are happening these days.
Yeah, tell me about that.
You know, I mean, not just, you know, tiny ones. For instance, okay, I'm going to tell you about a Viking folk festival I went to in Norway a little while ago. Really interesting, you know, when it was all just...
Were they wearing Viking helmets?
Of course they were. You know, lots of Nordic music and all that.
Was there any pillage going on?
No pillage, sadly, you know, or I missed it. I probably fell asleep on all the mead. But yeah, summer festivals are looking incredibly exciting indeed. Iron Maiden are obviously on tour next year as well, which is a really big deal for me. You know, Judas Priest headlining Bloodstock Festival, and you know, as a bit of a heavy metal fan, I got to plug those guys too.
Is Glastonbury off this coming year?
I believe so. You know, to be honest,
will people survive?
How will they survive? I don't know how they do survive. To be honest, you know, it's just
Aren't they moving Glastonbury from its current site?
Yeah, I've heard some very interesting things about what's going on there.
Yeah. That's very, very interesting. I'm the last man, I think I must be the last man, who stops on the motorway and buys CDs. I know I'm the last man because there are fewer and fewer for sale. More and more talking books, actually, which I've just gotten into myself. How do people buy music, by and large, now?
Well, you know, it's interesting because even the concept of downloading tracks seems to be changing, where iTunes have talked about phasing out downloading MP3s. It's all streaming, you know. I mean, they want you to be connecting to their platforms at all times. So Spotify, iTunes seem to be like the big names in the game. And now,
but what do you play it on?
You play it on your phone, like where you read everything, like where you communicate with everybody. I mean, it's just like...
And is the sound as good?
No, of course not, you know. But, you know, I think that people are willing to sacrifice quality for convenience.
Wow. It's been fantastic talking to you, Alexander, I must say.
Likewise.
And thanks for that review of the music scene in 2017. Alexander Milas, who's the MD of Twin V, and of course, a music journalist, and an all-round sage and font of knowledge on the music scene. Thank you very much.
My absolute pleasure.
Now, look east, they say. Jamie East has come into the studio and is about to take up this chair and this microphone. Jamie, nice to meet you.
Nice to meet you too. How are you, sir?
I'm good, yeah. I'm kind of desperate to get out of here, if you know my, if you get my drift.
I catch your drift.
And we've got Sarah Khan, whom I haven't seen for quite some time. It's very, very nice to see you.
You're looking very well,
Well,
sir.
And you. I was going to say, you don't look a day older than the many years ago that I saw you. So, are you a double act?
We are. We're doubling up tonight, aren't we, Jamie?
One night only.
One night only.
Exclusive.
Come in, get involved. Yeah.
Well, absolutely. Yeah, but it'll live forever on the internet, of course.
Exactly.
This event will live and live. Jamie, what have you got for us?
We are going to be talking Family Feud. I think you touched upon it as well.
The Gallaghers, yes.
Yeah. But it's a nice Christmassy story, I think, kind of getting together for Christmas again.
How plausible is it?
I think it's quite plausible. I think there's probably ulterior motives with Glastonbury not being around next year, but we'll probably touch upon that as well. We're also going to be
Who cares if there's brotherly love? They were a good act.
Oh no, they absolutely were. Yeah.
If they can, even if they hate each other, they can be a good act again.
Part of me is going to miss the feud as well, I think.
Yeah, yeah. The emphasis on the word act.
But as a mother, it's nice that they get on and can make the music as well. There's positives more than negatives.
I know people who know their mother very well. She still lives in her council house. In Burnage, just off Levenshulme in Manchester, and she very much wants them
to get on. Yes. I suspect it's more for Peggy than for themselves.
Yes.
So we're talking about that. We're also going to be talking about the state of affairs with the legal system at the moment in terms of the rape accusations and all the cases that they're having to relook at.
Well, it's very disturbing. The fact that two cases in a week collapsed is disturbing. Yeah. But the withholding of absolutely critical evidence, whether deliberate or inadvertent, you can take your pick.
And as you well know, it's kind of this is only the two that we've heard about so far.
Yes, yes. And I just saw my old parliamentary colleague Gerry Hayes on the television saying that this is the tip of the iceberg.
Yeah.
So this could be the beginning of a new crisis, really.
Yeah, absolutely. And it's a really serious one as well. There are no winners here.
No, of course. If it puts people off reporting to the police crimes that actually have happened, that's a catastrophe. If false allegations against people are made, that's also a catastrophe.
That's right.
If the legal system isn't capable of handling the difference between those two things, that's also a catastrophe. No winners, as you're saying.
So we're going to have a bit of a look at that as well, and also delving into Bitcoin. Do you have any Bitcoins?
Well, Max Kaiser claims he gave me one. I'm sure he gave me
Find
a voucher.
Quickly.
Yeah, well, we've searched the house. I'm sure he gave me a voucher for one, but he claims he gave me one. And if he did, it's now worth
a lot of
tens
money.
Of thousands of pounds.
That's right.
You can understand why I'm searching.
Yeah.
I'm cutting open mattresses and turning furniture upside down.
And we're also going to be talking about the male menopause. Now, we women talk about ours a lot, but it is a medical condition, and I'm going to be asking Jamie, reading out a couple of symptoms, to see actually what his state of health is at the moment.
He looks way too young to be experiencing any kind of midlife crisis. I myself have not experienced a midlife crisis because I haven't reached midlife yet. Jamie East and Sarah Khan coming up next.